this segment, we're going to learn how to troubleshoot a resistance-based sensor. And we're going to start out really simple with a voltage divider module. And this is a 2-to-1 voltage divider module. And we need a few things to be ready. So I need a meter, a digital multimeter. You want multiple ranges. This is a very inexpensive model, so it has manually selected ranges. More advanced models will have auto ranging, but you will have voltage settings and resistance settings. So we're going to be using resistance settings indicated by the ohm. And you need a screwdriver because you will be undoing some connections. You need something to take notes with. And you need some way to see the current readings on the data logger. And I'm using a keypad display today. And a very important piece is you need that wiring diagram. So in the sensor manual, you will find a wiring diagram. A wiring diagram will indicate several resistors. There's going to be at least two. And if your sensor only has one, the other ones you're going to add either one that's internal to the data logger or with an input module similar to that 2-to-1 divider. On a sensor, you'll just have sensor leads coming off and they should indicate wire colors. On this terminal input module, there's pegs that come off the bottom. These are the connections on this side. These ones are the screw terminals on it, these top side connections. And fixed value resistors will have a number with them. They might also be labeled RF for fixed. The ones that change resistance, in a sensor you'll have one that changes, it will be labeled RS for sensing. It's pretty common, or you might have a different symbol. And when you look at the diagram, you gotta plan pathways for your measurements. So to measure this 110 kilo ohm resistor, I wanna go from this H to this H. And to measure this 10 kilo ohm, I wanna go from this H to this H. And these wire crossings, you'll notice they're different. When you have a dot, that indicates those are connected electrically. If the lines cross over without a dot, they just go right past each other. Okay. So we're just gonna look at this side of the voltage divider, and we're gonna check both those 10 kilo ohm resistors. So I've got my meter, I've got it switched on. I'm gonna put it on a 20 kilo ohm range because that will cover that 10 kilo ohm resistor I'm measuring. And I'll touch my probes together, make sure it's working. It will drop near zero because the probes are low resistance. So I'm going to measure, let's go from that H to that H to measure this first resistor. And I'm getting a reading, but you notice a big problem. The reading is jumping a lot. The reason being, this VX channel in the data logger is output an excitation voltage. And there's also a ground connection. And the multimeter is output an excitation voltage all at the same time. And so the excitation voltage of the data logger and the meter, they conflict. So they won't get along together. So we have to disconnect the sensor from the data logger to get a reading. Okay. All the excitation connections and all the ground connections have to be disconnected. When you have a removable terminal strip, it can be pretty convenient to just pull that out. Though any sensor that's connected on this, it's not going to be read by the data logger when I pull it out. So make notes in your field book about what time you disconnect sensors and make a note again when you reconnect them. And before I pull that out, I want to get a reading. And the data logger says 0.50001. And so this is a 2-to-1 voltage divider. So I expect to get half my excitation voltage going in. So that is actually what I expected the data logger show. So let's pull this out and see if we can get a good reading with the meter. So I'm going that same H to H, that same reading I was trying to do earlier, 10.0. And you see it's pretty stable now. Okay, so we've got the H to H is the 10.0. Let's try this one. So to measure that one, I have to go H to ground. And so there's that pegs up under there. And it's connected here. I'm going to this ground and 10.0, which is what I expected. So if we take a longer pathway and I go from this H to that ground, it should give me that 10 plus that 10. So I'm going to set my meter up to a higher range to cover that 20 kilohms I expect. And it can be a little bit tricky handling the probes. And you saw things were shorting out when I had this lined up wrong. So yeah, I'm getting that 20. And see, I've got things on here that I could be shorting out on this ground lug. There's various things that could be touching. So it can be a bit tricky handling those terminal strips, trying to get good contact with those terminals and getting a good reading. Let's move on to an actual sensor. So right here on this terminal strip, I have a 107 temperature probe connected. And I have the wiring diagram from its manual. And you'll see this in this diagram, this symbol is different. That symbol is a resistor with a line through. So that's a variable resistor. And as I mentioned, sometimes you'll have an RS for sensing. But this symbol, you notice it's not a simple resistor symbol. This is a variable. This is a thermistor. It's going to change resistance with temperature. And there's a 1 kilo ohm fixed resistor here and a 249 kilo ohm fixed resistor here. So since DLR can't measure this when I have it disconnected, I'm going to plan my measurements with the multimeter I'm going to do so I can check all the wires and all the resistors. Okay, so I want to get a reading from black to red, and I want to get a reading from purple to red. So plan those out so we don't have to keep the sensor disconnected longer than we need to. So first off, I need to get a reading. Let's go into the real-time tables. And I've got 25.35, and you see it's changing because this is a temperature sensor. It picks up small changes in temperature. So it is changing on me because the resistance and the sensor is changing. So I'm going to make note of it right now, 25.34 Celsius. And then let's disconnect these. So since I had trouble measuring right on the screw terminals, I'm going to actually disconnect these wires. Before I do that, I want to have pictures of the wiring on the data logger. Take pictures of how you find it. And take pictures from multiple angles, because the way the light hits the wires, it can be hard to see some colors. So there's a purple wire and a black wire here. And in some lighting, it can be really difficult to tell that purple apart from the black. When you take pictures from different angles, it can be easier to see which wire is going on which terminal number. So I'm going to go ahead and disconnect these. Let's pull them out. And I want to do red to purple. And to make things easier to hold those probes to those wires, I'm going to use some clips. And these are really inexpensive. They're a useful tool to have. And red probe versus black probe does not matter as far as the multimeter leads. Resistance measurement's going to be the same, forwards or backwards. So I've got the purple. And I also need the red. So I can clip in those. And I'm going to turn it down to a lower range because this is only 1,000 ohms. And I'm getting 1,025. And because you can get resistance from these connections if you don't have things clipped well. So be aware of that. And this is an inexpensive meter. So I'm off I could be off by 2-3%, and it could be within the specs of this meter. So 1026. So power is getting through, voltage is getting through there. There's no broken connection, and it's pretty close to that 1000 I'm expecting. So that connection is good. And let's plan the next connection. I need to go from black to red to get those two. So I'm going to take this purple one off, and I'm going to put on the black. And it's over range, so I got to go to a bigger range. And I have 348, and this is 348 kiloohms, because I'm on a range that has a K. So I'm going to make note of that. I've got, well, I guess it's moved now to 349, so we'll take that. And at this point, I can go in and hook these wires back up to the data logger. So this data logger can start reading it again. So I'm looking at my wiring diagram. This purple was a ground. Red was my signal, and that one was, you have to know which channel number. I was in 5H for my signal. The shield wire also goes in the ground. And then my black was an excitation, and that was in VX3. Okay. Now, I'm going to check my readings again, make sure the data logger can read it again, because I don't want to leave the station with a wiring problem. And I've got 25.32. So I'm going to make a note of that. So I've got my notes, and it's also good, make a note in your field manual, what time you reconnected things, what the readings were. Okay, so I can set that, I can set my equipment aside, because I have the numbers I need. And at this point, I can take time to convert it, to compare it to the data logger readings. Because some sensors have pretty simple conversions, and other ones are a bit more complicated. So you see this is a thermistor equation. And so it's got several parameters. It will take me a while to sit down and calculate this. I would probably open up my laptop, get a spreadsheet out, and put all the numbers in. So that's why we want to make notes and then just quickly do our measurements, write down your resistance values, and then hook things back up. And then you have as much time as you need to do the calculations. In the case of this sensor, there's a handy table and in the back of the manual that gives me resistance versus temperature. So I need to know the resistance of that thermistor, and I measured 349 on this pathway. That included this 249, this thermistor, and the resistance of the cable. So most sensors, the resistance of the cable doesn't matter. Resistance of the cable usually only going to be 1 or 2 ohms, depends on how long the cable is. And so 2 ohms versus 249,000, it's a pretty small amount. So kind of insignificant. If you look at something like a PRT, you know, we're dealing with 1,000 ohms. So 2 ohms makes a bigger difference. We don't need to worry about the cable resistance on this one. So when you take this 349, you got 349K, and we subtract that 249K, and that thermistor was 100K. And it happens to be that 100,000, it would put us right at 25 Celsius. And I was reading 25.34 and then 25.32 on the day log. So it's really close. And as I said, to do a better measurement, or at least as good as day logger, you'd have to have a pretty expensive meter. So that result is close enough, given the equipment I'm using, to say the day logger is reading the sensor correctly. And I'm indoors, 25 Celsius is a very reasonable temperature for an indoor air temperature. So I'm within range. If the day logger was reporting 35 Celsius, and then I check it with my meter, and I'm also coming up with 35 Celsius, that would be a really hot indoor temperature. So that would make me question the sensor, but I would know the day logger is working right, I had it wired right, and so then the issue must be with the sensing element of the sensor. So you can, at that point, you refer to the manual for the sensor. Look to see if it had a troubleshooting section. Look to see if there's talk about calibration procedures, maintenance procedures. Sometimes a sensor can be fouled up. It can be dirty, and it just needs to be cleaned in the field, and it'll work correctly. Other sensors might need to go to calibration. And to really be sure if things are off, you know, say if this was off by 3 degrees Celsius, I wouldn't know that without having another sensor to compare it to. So having an own good sensor to swap in the field, if I suspect a calibration issue, that's how you would solve it. And with really precise, really accurate measurements, you'd have to send that sensor into a calibration lab to be certain. And you'll encounter sensors that have more complicated circuits. So what we dealt with was a half bridge. So a half bridge, there's two resistors in a half bridge sensor. And a full bridge has four resistors. So they look a lot more complicated. The conversion equations are more complicated. But how you check those resistor values is going to be the same. You still plan pathways. You just plan pathways through which two connections you need to measure just a single resistor. And you plan a pathway for the other ones. And so you're just hooking up your probes, checking pathways one resistor at a time. Then you make your notes, and then you reconnect things. And then at that point, just take your time to do the math to compare it.